your attention. Midfielder Dr. Leroy Williams from the CIAC will present the Class LL Football Championship plaque to Southington High School.
Great moments are born from great opportunity. And that's what you have here tonight, boys. That's what you've earned here tonight. One game. If we played them 10 times, they might win 9. But not this game. Not tonight. Tonight, we stay with them. And we shut them down because we can. You were born to be players. Every one of you. This is your time. Now go out there and take it.
I'm Steve Risser. Welcome to another of Seesaw Productions' highlight videos of Southington High School. This time, honoring the 2013 Blue Knights football team, a crew of young men that head coach Mike Drury would refer to time and time again as one of the closest knit and hardest working teams he's ever led. And by working so hard every moment and taking advantage of every opportunity they could to improve themselves, this band of Blue Knight brothers will forevermore have the title of champions next to their name.
Southington High School football, wow, what a ride. 10 years, 4 coaches. It started with Jude Kelly, and then Jude decided he was gonna retire, and then Bill Mella comes in. Bill takes us to 3 straight playoff seasons. That's pretty amazing. That tells you about the talent that we have here in Southington. And then Bill decided he was gonna go back to college football. DJ Hernandez came in, I met him, I liked him. He's a great guy, very intense. There were a lot of questions about who was going to come in and replace DJ when he decided he was going to go back and coach at the college level. I just felt like we needed to have somebody who was going to stay and build a program. And I saw that person in Mike Drury.
The end of last year's season with the loss to Glastonbury at home in the quarterfinals was really something that kind of left a sour taste in everyone's mouth, coaching staff, players alike. The guys really decided to take it upon themselves, and they said it. You know, the seniors meet with them at the end of the season that, you know, they weren't going to let that happen again. It's one thing to say something like that, but it's another thing to get out there and prove it, get out there and work for it. And that's what these seniors did. As a coaching staff, you know, we knew that we wanted to revamp things a little bit. We wanted to change stuff offensively, and that just didn't happen overnight just by thinking about it. You know, we spent a lot of hours meeting, and it was once, twice a week throughout the entire off season, and really reflecting and really looking at everything we do from organizational standpoint on both sides of the ball to a practice standpoint, and how we do things and how we're going to prepare these guys. And by us doing that and really taking the time to make sure everything was perfect, the dividends paid big time.
Off season, spring ball. We know what we got to do. We do what we need to do to get ready for the summer. Captains are chosen. Steve Barmore, Tyler Hyde, Zach Maxwell, Jimmy Nardi. Kids that I knew could be and should be leaders.
Being named captain, I mean, it was a huge honor to be selected by my teammates. I was very excited when I got chosen, obviously. Just to be able to be in that position that so many past great players have been was really just a huge honor.
named captain, it's just a, it's a great honor because of the tradition that we have here with, in the school and in the football program. So so it was really nice that, that my other teammates thought that I was worthy, you know, to be a captain, and that was certainly a nice gesture from them to me.
A great honor. I mean, looking at all the captains before me, knowing what they've done and what they did for the program, it was just a great honor, and I know I had great expectations.
Being named a captain meant a lot to me. I kind of looked up to this pro football program for a really long time. Ever since I was little, I kind of dreamed of being a captain. To be a captain of this team, it made me like see my role of being a leader on the team.
All the preparation that goes into being able to become a team that competes for the playoffs, competes for conference championship, competes for a state championship. This group did that, and these seniors really took it upon themselves to raise the bar, and we talked about that. We're going to raise the bar this year, and that's what their goal was, and that's what their mentality was.
The 2013 Blue Knights football season would start much in the way that it had ended, with weather playing a major role in the scheduling of its games. Originally slated to take place on the evening of Thursday, September 12th, the season opener against the arch-rival Tomahawks of Glastonbury High School would be rescheduled for Friday, September 13th at a special 3 p.m. kickoff time in Glastonbury. Having lost to the Tomahawks in the first round of the previous year's CIAC Class AA playoffs, the Blue Knights had revenge on their minds during this CCC interdivisional grudge match.
This was a game that, you know, obviously our kids really starred, circled, underlined on their calendars leading up to this season, because not only are they one of our biggest rivals, it was also our last loss and our only loss last year, which kept us from moving on in the playoffs. So these kids, you know, really wanted to get up there and take it to them.
The game would remain close for most of its duration, but in the fourth quarter, Tyler Hyde would come through for the Knights, taking off on a dramatic 57-yard touchdown run that would erase a brief Glastonbury lead and give Southington High School its first victory of the season. Final score, the Blue Knights 16, the Tomahawks 9.
They beat us at our place, quarterfinals. We don't like when people beat us at home, obviously, so getting back at them at their place.
The kids pulled out a hard-fought win, played great defensively, really out-hit them.
The next three games for the 2013 Blue Knights would be scheduled to take place in Southington at home under the Friday night lights on the recently renovated Fontana Field. During this three-game stretch, a stingy Southington High School defense would make each of its opponents feel very unwelcome, pitching one shutout and holding the other two to only one score apiece. In a convincing 41-8 victory over the Manchester Indians, a 38-0 dismantling of the Simsbury Trojans, and a 38-7 domination of the Hurricanes of New Britain High School.
Following Glastonbury, we had a nice three-game stretch at Fontana Field, first game being Manchester. We came out firing all cylinders that game, and I thought that was one of our best play games throughout the regular season, flying around, making hits, and offensively, things started to progress, and guys started to get it and understand some of the stuff that we were doing. And things really started to take off. Simsbury, that's an offense that you really got to prepare for. Kids really have to be dialed in, focused, and they were. You know, their head coach said to me after the game, that was, you know, one of the best defenses he's seen in a while. The way we flew to the ball and the way we played extremely disciplined and assignment football against them. Hard-hitting New Britain, who came into our house with a little bit of a sluggish start first half, but our guys really started to impose their will and started to, you know, make a lot of plays in that second half, and we pulled away.
The Southington High School Blue Knights would post a 133-24 scoring differential over its first four opponents and put the rest of the CCC Division I West on notice that they were a team to be reckoned with during the 2013 campaign. Don't say it's all right.
Walking down the sideline at Hall, I could see how they were playing. And I could see how our guys were thinking, all right, we're good. And they thought I was nuts because I was muttering to myself, not enough, not enough. I walked up and down the line saying, not enough, not enough. Hall came back and tied us at the end of the first half. We got up on them again, and then here it goes.
After going 4-0, the Blue Knights would spend the remainder of the month of October in West Hartford, playing back-to-back away games in that town over the next two Saturdays. The first of these opponents, the much-improved Warriors of Hall High School, would prove to be the only bump in the road for the 2013 Blue Knights.
I think the Hall game was the most important game because it was just really a big wake-up call.
The Hall game kind of changed our whole perspective on the season, and it kind of made us thinking that we're all big and tough because we're winning every game by 40. It kind of made us realize that we have to continue working as hard as we can throughout the season.
Though Southington would score the first three touchdowns of the game, Hall would claw its way back into the contest, scoring 28 unanswered fourth quarter points and stealing the victory. Final score, the Warriors 49, the Blue Knights 37.
I thought we played a lot of energy and we just came up short. With that being said, I think we learned a lot about ourselves as a team after this game. We learned that we need to have 100% focus at all times, and the kids bought into that.
Never seen a game with so many momentum shifts and do anything right. You know, our defense, we had a bad day on defense, and then the offense didn't convert when we needed to. I think it was definitely the most important game of the season because it was a wake-up call for us that we weren't as good as we thought we were. And we came into practice the next week and for the rest of the season, you know, determined to right the wrong that was that game.
And I think this loss here was one of the biggest springboard for us this season in terms of bringing our focus back.
That might have been the best thing that happened to us because it showed us that we needed to stay focused for four quarters.
Their next journey to West Hartford the following Saturday afternoon would end on a more pleasant note, as the Blue Knights would regroup and get back to their winning ways, this time against the Chieftains of Conard High School. Senior Zach Maxwell would lead the charge on both sides of the ball as the Blue Knights would make easy work of the Conard team and improve its record to 5-1 on the season. Final score, the Blue Knights 56, the Chieftains 27.
We got to be prepared. It's time to bounce back. We have to have our best game yet. Broke out Zach Maxwell at running back, and he had some big physical bruising runs and really kind of got this machine rolling in the direction that we wanted to get to.
As November began, Southington High School would play in the town of Newington. And just like the week before, a Blue Knights offense would put up 56 points on the scoreboard as Barmore passed for four touchdowns and Alex Giamelli broke the Southington High School season touchdown receiving record, hauling in TD numbers 16 and 17 during Southington's sixth win of the season. Final score, the Blue Knights 56, the Indians 20. The Blue Knights would finish off their regular season home schedule with two back-to-back victories over East Hartford and South Windsor, beating the Hornets 55-20 and the Bobcats 45-0. The South Windsor game would also serve as senior night, giving Blue Knights head coach Mike Drury a chance to say his goodbyes to the class of 2014.
South Windsor, obviously a great night, and it was potentially that time period and the way things were shaping up with the playoffs. This could be our last home game on Fontana Field. It was an emotional night for the seniors. It was a really nice night, being able to cheer off our senior offensive players and our senior defensive players. That was something real special, something that, you know, we wanted to do for those guys to let them know that, you know, we care about them and that they've had a tremendous career here at Fontana Field. Next up on the agenda, Cheshire High School.
Gentlemen, everyone needs to get one of these. You need to put it on your right hand. Anytime I see you, remember, and Cheshire must be destroyed. What are you going to say, guys?
Cheshire must be destroyed.
Again!
Cheshire must be destroyed.
I state your name.
I state your name.
Again.
And Cheshire must be destroyed.
And Cheshire must be destroyed again on here.
Oh. With liberty and fraternity for all.
Amen.
A victory during the annual Thanksgiving Day game against the Cheshire Rams in Cheshire would put the Blue Knights in a position to make the playoffs for the second year in a row. While Drury and his players and coaching staff attended to the game on the field, the Southington football faithful kept one eye on the game and the other on their smartphones, checking the scores of several other Class AA games around the state to see where the Blue Knights' final seeding would end up. Southington High School would go on to win the 18th annual Apple Valley Classic, destroying the Rams 38-6. And shortly after their victory, Southington Director of Athletics Eric Swallow would discover that he didn't need to make travel arrangements for his varsity football team for the following Tuesday, but rather he needed to get Fontana Field ready to host a playoff game for the second consecutive season.
He talked about when they got in the playoffs, the first year they knocked on the door. Second year they kicked that door in. Here's our door. That's what's at stake. We gonna knock on the door like last year, or we gonna kick that door in?
The 2013 Blue Knights football playoff run would begin on Tuesday, December 2nd. Their opponent, Norwich Free Academy. The last time NFA and Southington met was during the 1998 Class AA State Championship game, in which Southington came away the victor by a score of 54-26, earning its first state championship in the sport of football. Southington High School was hoping for the same results this time around against the Wildcats. Though Norwich had spent most of the season among the top seeds in the Class AA playoff rankings, a loss to New London on Thanksgiving Day saw them drop down to the number 5 seed and forced them to play on the road in the quarterfinal round.
Short turnaround, Cheshire going into NFA. It's Thursday to Tuesday. You know, that's a quick turnaround. We had some really good practices. Our preparation was great. Our kids were dialed in. We had a lot of great meetings and practices, and our conditioning was at a top level at that point. I get a call Tuesday afternoon, Mike Barmore, telling me he ordered the door. So I'm thinking, what door are we talking about here? Coach Earl, great motivator, always comes up with some really unique things to get kids going.
Pre-game speech, Coach Earl, he was talking about Earl Campbell, and he said that his first year when they made the playoffs, they just knocked on the door. The year after that, they kicked it down, and Jerry kicked down the door, and that got us all fired up. Going into that game, our mindset was to just break every kid on that team's will.
NFA walked on the field, ready to try and make a run for the championship. No one picked us to beat NFA. But once again, our boys, our men, were ready for whatever came our way.
I mean, we knew we had a shot at beating them. They're a very athletic team. We felt that we could out-discipline them. Going into the game, we started off a little slow in the first quarter offensively. Defense was playing great.
We kicked the door in this playoffs. We took it to NFA in all aspects of the game, defensively, offensively, special teams-wise. You know, getting our offense going as they started to get clicking, the defense really stepped up in that first quarter and a half where the offense had a couple three and outs and the defense just stifled the NFA's offense.
The Southington offense started slowly in this quarterfinal game. However, the defense was able to keep the Wildcats at bay until the Barmore Hyde machine could get itself warmed up. And by the end of this contest, Hyde would run for 4 touchdowns and Barmore would pass for 3 more. Meanwhile, the Southington High School defense would allow Norwich Free Academy only 2 visits into the end zone during the entire game. 3 second quarter touchdowns over a 5-minute stretch would see to it that the Blue Knights would never have to look back. The final score, the Blue Knights 52, the Wildcats 14.
Started off a little slow, but we got going second quarter and they just couldn't stop us. Defense came up big, shut them down all game, and it was awesome.
We went into that game and executed greatly. The line did an amazing job, obviously, for me. Everyone did a great job. That was possibly one of the best games we've played all season.
Tyler had a great game running. He had a tremendous game with 4 touchdowns. And I said after that game, he ran like a man possessed. Steve played very well. The offensive line, being undersized, took it to NFA.
Our defense played tremendously throughout the entire game. NFA gave a part of the game to us by losing their composure, which is one of the things that we do not do. NFA had a sideline warning. They had several personal fouls against them. Our team played with composure. They played with class. They played like we expect Southington High School football players to play. And we defeated NFA.
After taking down the Wildcats, the Blue Knights would have only a few short days of preparation to get ready for its next playoff opponent, the Tigers of Richfield High School. Coming off their 35-33 victory against the number one seeded Newtown Nighthawks, Richfield had a lot of momentum on their side.
So you go from Tuesday to a Saturday game, a state semifinal game, and that's a quick turnaround for kids. We have a Thursday, Tuesday, and then Saturday. So they're playing 3 games in less than 2 weeks, about a week and a half. We know that that's tough, but our kids are tough.
There was a little bit on social media about how Ridgefield was going to manhandle the underpowered and undersized Southington High School football team. The word was out. We were going to get our tails handed to us. Not this year, ladies and gentlemen.
After NFA, you know, all the offensive coaches basically told us that, you know, we're able and we're capable to score 50 points a game, even on playoff teams, just as we did with NFA.
2 days to prepare for a Richfield team, which just scored a bunch of points versus Newtown. They have a prolific passing attack, a very good running back. So we're facing a team that was playing very well at this time period. Preparing for that in 2 days is tough. And the kids were dialed in. They were meeting after practice. They were staying extra late for practice, watching film, meetings, doing all the things to take care of the mental piece of the game to make sure we were where we wanted to be.
Obviously feeling pretty good. We beat up one of the best teams and facing another good running back and another explosive offense. So we all just felt comfortable going into the Richfield. Our mindset was we were going to take it all the way, and I think that was the difference between this year and last year.
Because this semifinal game would have to be played at a neutral site, the CIAC used geography and chose West Haven High School for the location of this Saturday afternoon playoff matchup. It was obvious right from the start that Coach Drury and his staff had done their homework getting ready for the Tigers, taking it to them early and often in this game. Jamelli grabbed 2 touchdown passes from Barmore and scored on interception return, while the defense limited Richfield quarterback Ryan Dunn to a season-low 46 yards, hurrying him into early throws the entire game, while intercepting and sacking him twice.
These guys played another clean football game, won the turnover battle. Penalties, few. Playing a game that way, you're going to put yourself in a good position to win. Richfield was another team. They came in on their coach buses, and we don't ever want to ride coach buses. We come in on the yellow bus. We came in literally right behind them, and they were rolled up in their coach buses. So all the kids in the bus and us coaches, we all looked back, we all looked at each other, and we just had a little smile on our face.
I'll turn this damn bus around. That'll end your precious little trip pretty damn quick, huh?
Richfield was to score 40 points in the first half, and we almost did that. We probably shot 45-0 at the end of 3 quarters, and we're in the JVs and in a single game. Really hard in practice that week, as it was focused on just Richfield and in every aspect of the game, and that's exactly what we did. I made a mockery of them in the semifinal game, that 5-0, but you know, it is what it is, and we did a really good job that day.
We talk about we as Blue Knights are brothers. The Record Journal said that the brothers Maxwell and the brothers Jamelli came at Ridgefield from both sides of the ball. What an amazing performance. 45-0.
And we talked about what our goals were this season and having that victory. And I remember looking at that scoreboard and dialed in 45-0. And we made a statement in the state, and I was just looking at it. And I was so proud of the guys, the players, and the coaches to get to this point and getting this win to be able to give ourselves that opportunity. We always talk about opportunity to play for a state championship.
In the end, this contest would end up as a blue nightmare for Ridgefield High. The final score, the Blue Knights 45, the Tigers nothing. Now all Southington needed to know was who would they play in the state championship game.
Final score in the other double L, Fairfield Prep 29, West Haven 26.
So now I get
to ring that bell.
I finally get to use that clip, man.
We're gonna ring that bell.
We're gonna ring the bell today.
Let's do this.
This is what you guys been working for.
I need 60 minutes. 60 minutes of me.
You got it.
60 minutes. No business. No mercy. Nothing but sound on the sound bubble. You got me. We're gonna ring the bell. We're gonna ring that championship bell.
Ding, mother. Dog.
Looking for a better way to get up out of bed instead of getting on the internet and checking a new hit me. Get up, first shot, come strut walking. A little bit of humble, a little bit of cautious. Somewhere between like Rocky and Cosby's for the game. Nope, nope, y'all can't copy yet. Bad moonwalking, and this here is our party. My posse's been on Broadway, and we did it all way. Chrome music, I shed my skin and put my bones into everything I record to it. And yeah, I'm on. Let that stage light go and shine on down. Got that Bob Barker suit game and Plinko in my style. Money, stay on my craft and stick around for those pounds. But I do that to pass the torch and put on for my town. Trust me, on my I-N-D-E-P-E-N-D-E-N-T. This hustling, chasing dreams since I was 14. With the four-track busting, halfway across that city with the back. Crush it, labels out here, now they can't tell me nothing. We give that to the people, spread it across the country. Labels out here, now they can't tell me nothing. We give it to the people, spread it across the country.
Can we go back? This is the moment. Tonight is the night. We'll fight till it's over. So we put our hands up like the ceiling can't hold us. Like the ceiling can't hold us. Can we go?
The Blue Knights would end up playing the Jesuits of Fairfield Prep for the 2013 Connecticut State Class LL football title in a game that was originally scheduled to take place at Central Connecticut State University on the evening of Saturday, December 14th. However, just as their first contest of the season, Mother Nature would see to it that the game would have to be rescheduled and rescheduled and rescheduled.
Saturday, December 14th, State Championship Saturday, big snowstorm predicted for the state of Connecticut. You get to the high school, Booster Club is cooking a great breakfast, players are roaming around, coaches are doing their X's and O's. The word comes in, game postponed, moved to Sunday, West Haven High School.
Coming off the semifinal championship win, we were flying pretty high, but we knew it had to be short-lived. We had a big prep week ahead of ourselves with Fairfield Prep. We knew they were going to be a great team. We were ready to get that game going Saturday. We knew there was going to be a potential situation for some weather. We didn't know how bad it was going to end up being.
We had the luncheon press conference, and at that point on that date, it was still determined that we would play on that Saturday night at Central Connecticut. As the week went on, as we all know, the weather became more problematic, and the CIAC made a decision that they did not want to play that night game. Then it became a situation where With the amount of snow and trying to get fields prepared to play so that they were safe became, again, another major issue. I know that the game then was moved to Sunday.
December 15th, Sunday, state championship Sunday. Booster Club cooks another great breakfast. Players are getting ready. Word comes out, game postponed. It's Monday. It's a school day. It's the third day in a row you're getting ready to play your state championship game. I watched the players walking through the halls with their jerseys on, with their heads up high, their shoulders back, and there's no doubt you are ready to go.
I mean, we're Saturday, we're getting taped, the whole team in the trainer's room, and all of a sudden they come and tell us it's postponed to Sunday. Same thing, Sunday, come in, eating breakfast, postponed again. Monday, we're in school, wearing our jerseys, you ready, postponed again.
Word comes in, 10 o'clock in the morning, game postponed.
Kind of said, you know, whenever we play the game, it'll happen, so we're gonna have to get confirmation first before we can get psyched up, because this is getting ridiculous. But, you know, when that day came, we were...
With the weather now cooperating, the Blue Knights and the Jesuits would finally get to the business of playing for the Class LL Championship on Thursday, December 19th, a mere 6 days before the Christmas holiday. Along with the day change came a venue change as well. West Haven High School would now serve as the battlefield, a location familiar to the Blue Knights.
State Championship Thursday. Finally, the game is on. West Haven High School, 6:30.
Finally, the CIAC declared that New Haven was suitable for the championship game. They determined that the field was playable, the stands were livable for our fans. But I guarantee you, it was a tough place to be if you weren't on the cleared part of the field.
National anthem comes on. Actually, it never did. Kickoff. Prep score 7-0.
Going into this game, we knew it was going to be a very physical football game. Fairfield Prep. One of the things that, you know, we talked about as a staff and we talked about with the team is how many people out there said that we were going to get out physical. So we made it a point of emphasis to be physically ready to play our brand of football, which is fast and physical.
I remember first play of the game, our first series, walking out there, looking at the guys and like, these guys are big. But I knew we could take them because we've been outside all year. And looking at the big nose guards, the big tackles, and we just wore them down.
They had giant people on their team. There was one point I remember looking down the field at their offensive line heading against our defense. I couldn't see any blue shirts. It was all these white shirts. I didn't even know where our team was.
The first quarter, you know, we struggled to get a couple things going offensively. We had a couple drops. We moved the ball a little bit, but we had to punt and play defense. I thought one of the things we were doing great in the first half as a defense is we were hitting them. We were being physical. We were making some hits. Regardless if they were getting some yardage on us, they were paying for it, and we made sure of that.
Southington, 7-7. Prep, 14-7. Prep scores again, 21-7.
Half, and they kind of ran all over us, and then we went in the second half and we were all calm. We were really just kind of said to each other that we needed to get done the second half, and we weren't playing the way that we had been playing all season in the first half.
We knew we were down, but I could speak for everybody when I say that we had the opinion that we weren't nervous, or we all thought we were gonna win.
We came into halftime down by 2 touchdowns. We came to the locker room and I noticed a lot of the guys' heads were down. I kind of just tried to get them fired up. I just tell them to have fun out there. We're in the state championship game.
During the championship game, when Fairfield Prep went up 21-14, one of the players came off the field and he had the most devastating look on his face. And just then, one of the students I work with walked over to him and said, "I hate this game. We're going to lose." The player put down the water bottle, put his arm around the student that I work with, and said, "We've got this. Stay positive. We've got this."
So as we were losing 28-14, I saw all the senior leadership not appearing concerned. And that actually made me feel more comfortable and confident. I think it probably made the rest of the team feel comfortable and confident too. So it was a tale of two halves for sure.
Going into the halftime, down 28-14, and the kids responded. The kids were ready. The kids were focused. When I went in there, I felt like I didn't even have to say much. It wasn't heads down. It wasn't sulking or pointing fingers. They were, hey, let's go. We got to play better. A colonel came up to me and he said, hey, Mike. And he had a serious look on his face. I need 3 seconds.
We go into halftime down 14 points. And as Mike is talking to the defense, I tap him on the shoulder and I say, Mike, I need 3 seconds. And he says, what, Colonel? And I said, Mike, as hard as it is, this is my last game.
He goes, I'm going to tell the kids this is my last game. And it kind of hit me as a shock. So I'm thinking like, oh, man.
And Jimmy Nardi promised me a ring before I leave.
What really got us going was that Colonel told us that he was retiring after the season.
Get me that ring. And they did.
Second half, critical drive to open the second half, and we shut prep down in 3 plays. Southington gets the ball, touchdown, Southington, 28-21.
The biggest thing was making them punt in that first possession, all right, and getting that ball back. So then we got the ball back, and then Alex made a tremendous play with a 60-yard touchdown catch from Steve, where he made just, I think, one of his signature catches and runs of the season.
Prep gets the ball again. We shut him down again. We get the ball. Touchdown, Blue Knights, 28-28. Ladies and gentlemen, we have a ball game.
Defensively, we make a couple more stops again. We really start to impose our will defensively, and I think they really felt the physical presence of our defense, flying around, hitting them, gang tackling. They were getting a little bit honest, but they weren't getting much, and not as much as they hoped for, and I think they were a little surprised of how physical of a team we were. Alex capped off the third quarter with a 4-yard touchdown pass from Steve, and that was huge right there. Going into the fourth quarter, tied up, I think momentum was fully in our favor, and our kids were ready. They're ready for that fourth quarter. This is something that they worked for the entire year, the entire offseason. And one thing I noticed as a coach and from there the sideline, their guys were kind of having their hands on their knees a little bit. They were huffing and puffing. And our guys, we were just getting started. We were just getting the engine warmed up. And it really started to click on all cylinders in the fourth quarter.
Third quarter ends 28-28. We start the fourth quarter. We get the ball. We drive the length of the field. And we kick the field goal. And we take the first lead of the game 31-28.
Luckily, we have Kyle Smick, who, in my mind, was the best kicker in the state this year. He crushed a 21-yard field goal for us, and we always talk about when we get inside that 20 or in, we're scoring.
We have outscored Prep 17-0 in the second half, taking total control of the game, and it looks like it's a Blue Knight win. Prep gets the ball. 80 yards. Touchdown, Prep. 34-31. They kick the extra point, and it hits the upright.
You know, they responded back with a touchdown. It didn't faze us. It really didn't, because we felt that we were able to do some things that we couldn't get done in the first half. The key was they failed the kick. So having that failure of the kick, it puts them up 34-31, and we're only down by three.
Now we're down by a field goal. Anybody's game. Blue Knights, you're not bothered by it. You take the ball, you drive the length of the field, touchdown, Southington, 38-34. What a game. Looks like the last team with the ball wins this one.
Next possession, we drive right down the field in about a minute 50, minute 45, and Steve connects on Jay for a big touchdown catch. Going up on him there, I think that was huge. Could be able to get up 38-34 and know that they needed a touchdown. They couldn't kick a field goal.
Prep gets the ball, forced to throw now. We're down to 6 minutes to go, and we get a big interception at midfield that's returned to the 30-yard line, and we're taking control.
Probably one of the best plays I've seen of the year. Steve felt that pressure with his pocket presence, just to be able to roll out, extend the play, which he's done all year tremendously, and kind of give that nonverbal communication to Alex to go up in the end zone. Steve throws it up, and Alex goes up and makes one of the best plays I've seen all year over two defenders and just willfully rips it out of their hands. Next possession, Prep gets the ball back, and they're moving the ball down the field a little bit, and then I think I am, at this point, out of my mind. I wanted to make sure the defense was ready, doing their job. We're in our cover two shell, and Steve's kind of creeping toward the middle of the field. I'm screaming at him to get over on the hash. He can't hear me, but Steve was dialed in at that point. He kind of had a good feel what he was doing out there. They try to throw a little quick seam on us, and Steve jumps it, and I knew once he caught that thing, I knew he was gone.
Pick six. That was the first defensive touchdown that I have scored in my high school career. My only two interceptions of the year came in that game. So to cap it off with that was just, it was unbelievable. First of all, I was shocked that I was able to, you know, read the quarterback and catch the ball. I bobbled it at first, so I thought I was going to drop it. Thank God I didn't. But you know, just such a rush at the end when I turned around and look at everybody cheering and you know, realized that, you know, it's over. You know, we won the state championship, and I might have teared up a little bit, I'm not sure. But,
touchdown, Blue Knights, 45-34 Southington. Pressure's on Prep. They have to score. They get the ball. They get a first down. And on the very next series, interception, 40-yard line. Pick six, touchdown Blue Knights, 52-34.
When Barmore caught that interception and he's running down the sideline and he's heading to a touchdown, that's it. I know that the game is over. I know that the state championship is won.
Couple minutes left to go in the game. Prep gives it their best shot. Our defense is tackling. There's eight guys on every tackle. No one is going to take this one away from us. Ball game ends. Southington High School, state champions, double L football for the state of Connecticut.
Double L champs, Southington High School.
My mom and dad for putting up with me every day, getting home at 8 o'clock, just watching extra film and stuff like that, and driving me around places that I needed to go. Shout out to coaching staff, especially for Gary, or to Gary, for getting his glasses and looking like Shannon Sharp every practice. Coach Nate, for being the biggest boss on the field at all times, and the coach Drury for being the most nuts guy that I know and probably will ever know. Shout out to Mike Lang, because I know he likes getting shout outs. Shout out to Steve Salmon for being probably my favorite person on the team this year. Shout out to my sisters who have helped out with all the football stuff for the past 2-3 years. I mean, they've been awesome. And shout out to anybody else that supported us throughout the entire season. You know, the community who had our back the entire season. So I appreciate their support, and we're state champs.
My last example of the character of this team is, after winning the state championship, it was one of the most exciting moments. And the boys started running on the field and celebrating. And then you heard one by one saying, "Go shake hands. We need to shake hands. Go shake hands." My advice, continue to be the person who says thank you. Continue to be the person who returns things they borrow. Continue to be the person that, no matter how devastated you are, you think of another person in need and you say, "You've got this."
Brothers out there, we had each other's back, and I think that was huge. Can we go into that second half of the Fairfield Prep game? Down 14 points, we just went into that locker room, stuck together, and we knew that we could do this, and we accomplished our goal. A shout out to all the families, the coaches, the teammates, the town, the cheerleaders, everyone for supporting us this whole year. Thank you, the coaching staff, so much. It's been an amazing career. I'm so happy I was able to play with this group of guys, and I can't wait to come watch you guys next year. So go kick some butt.
Congratulations, everybody, on a fantastic season. Congratulations goes out to the entire football program on winning a state championship. That is not an easy thing to do, and it takes leadership and hard work from top to bottom. Our football program would not be where it is today without Mike Drury and his entire coaching staff putting in the number of hours with the kids. It also wouldn't be where it is today without the leadership of our captains and our senior leaders. And when I think about our leadership, I think about the fact that I came in 4 years ago as the high school principal, and these kids were simply freshmen coming into a new building. How far they have come over the past 4 years. Also, huge shout out to the Colonel. You're a rock and you're a rock star. You lead quietly behind the scenes. You are the man, and this program is going to miss you. And thank you so much for everything you've done.
I won the states for wrestling, and winning the states for football with my brothers, there's no other feeling like it. It doesn't even compare to anything else. And next year, I know you're gonna kill it out there next year. Good luck to you, and I know you're gonna have the best year ever. And also, I want to hand down my jersey to Vance. I like the way you play, and I think you'll be a great addition to the 3-4 legacy.
We took the knee, and it was just the best feeling in the world. I mean, I've been with these guys since youth football, and to finally win a state championship with them, it feels incredible. There's no other feeling like it. All right, well, shout out to my quarterback, Barmore. Thank you for a great 4 years. I knew you were gonna do big things ever since freshman year. Have fun at Yale. Shout out to Mike Lang. Shout out to my offensive line. And shout out to the coaching staff, especially. Thank you for everything you guys have done throughout the season, and especially me. And you guys have made me the best football player possible. And 25, I've talked to all the past 25s, and we would like Matt Maxwell to represent 2-5 next year.
After that game, it was just such a proud moment, because seeing those kids and the absolute joy on their faces, and seeing the pictures afterwards, and seeing the joy, seeing the euphoria on everyone's faces, the coaches and the community, and bringing the chip back home. I was exhausted after the game because it was intense, and I was just so proud of these guys and the coaches and how they responded, and for the absolute top honor that can happen as a high school football player.
First off, just like to really thank the parents, the Gridiron Club, for their tremendous support this past season. Without you guys, these guys, and they wouldn't be able to get to where they are today, or we wouldn't be able to as well. You guys sacrificed a lot, bringing the kids in the morning, waking up at 5:15, dragging them there. That just really shows your dedication to the program and to your sons as well. I'd like to thank the community and all community members for their support and everything they've done for our program and everything that they continue to do. You know, we really appreciate it, and I know the boys appreciate it a lot as well. Coaches, you guys done a great job this year. I'm glad to have you guys, and glad to say that you guys are my staff, and really appreciate all the hard work, dedication that you put into these guys year in, year out, and every week in the off season, all the stuff that you know we do that not many people know. I really appreciate it, and let's keep it rolling. Players, you, my seniors, first off, I just want to tell you guys, it's been an unbelievable journey with you. I remember seeing you and a lot of you guys when you were younger and freshmen, and I was up here coaching with the varsity at the time as defensive coordinator, and I knew that there was some talent down there. But what really impressed me the much about how you guys have developed, you've developed into great young men. You've shown that you are great leaders, tremendous character. People in the building really like you and care about you, teachers, staff, everybody, and other kids in the building. They look up to you. You have a work ethic that's unmatched, and I think one that should be looked upon to be duplicated, because you guys really worked for everything you deserved. And you guys also have great personalities. I really enjoyed my time spending all those hours and days and all these years with you guys, and it's been a real pleasure being able to come out on top and finish what we set forth to get done with the state championship. Underclassmen, you guys have seen the outcome of hours and years of work and dedication to something. I want to just let you know that I'm looking forward to working with you guys. I'm looking forward to getting you guys back here. This year we rose the bar. We talked about raising the bar. It's time to get back there. It's not time to slack off. It's not time to say, hey, we're champions. Now it's your guys' turn, and it's your guys' turn to become champions. And let's get it done again in 2014.
I'm sitting here with some of our motivational things for the season. And I would introduce one of these before a lot of the practices. We have our hold the rope, which all the kids, I heard them were going at halftime against Fairfield Prep, and I could hear them saying hold the rope, which means don't give up, dig in. It's a shout out to all the players. I'm very proud of the effort, the hard work that everybody put in, and just a shout out to all the guys, and a real shout out to all the parents, and I wish everybody the best of luck.
I would like to thank a lot of people. First and foremost, to the coaching staff, outstanding job. What you do, X's and O's, is one thing. What you have done to turn boys into young men says a lot more. We had a great group of football players this year. We had a better group of gentlemen because of you guys. To the equipment managers, to the trainers, to the booster club, and most importantly to the parents, thank you for everything that you have done. Our group of young men could experience what they had this year. And if it wasn't for you people, they would not have had that opportunity. So again, a shout out to all of you, and thank you very much for what you have done.
Gentlemen, I am very proud of you seniors. I couldn't be more proud of you guys. You did what you came to do. You did what you planned to do. You did what you dreamed you would do. You achieved greatness. You won the state championship. I'm very proud of you. Juniors, sophomores, freshmen. The reason these men won a state championship, with help from the junior class, I have to admit, we had a lot of starters on that are juniors. But the reason this team did what it did was because they were focused, they were dedicated, they gave 100% every single day, every time they came in, every action they took, 100%. I challenge you to do the same thing. You cannot let up in the weight room. You cannot let up on the field. You cannot let up in the classroom. You have to be what they are. Dedicated, focused, winners. You do that, we'll have another championship. It's up to you now. This season is over. Now it's on you. Carry on the torch. Carry on the tradition. Carry on the winning. Don't let me down.
One of the things that that sticks in my mind is after we tied the game 28-28, Carlos Gill came over to me and said, "Colonel, we're going to get you that ring." And I just hugged. And if you ask any of the players, I don't even high-five the players, but this crew was special. They were the best. They were state champions.
This is my life. All these feelings I've shared, and these are my dreams that I've never lived before. Somebody shake me, 'cause I must be sleeping. Now that we're here so far away, all the shown before. Somebody shake me, 'cause I must be sleeping. Yeah.
This is your time.
For Southington High School Blue Knights football and Seesaw Productions, I'm Steve Risser. Thanks for watching.
That's all, folks.